many, many years ago, I once followed, not that I really understood it, but a course in the theory of flamenco, which was a virtual course, by the way, so in Spain. And final assignment was to come up with something smart around how you could teach usefully flamenco. Story was that we lived 3 years in the south of Spain. And that's where we got bugged up. And it's sort of the beginning of the story. We ever continued. Erna dances flamenco. So if I can ask Tanya just to introduce the gang and then show you what flamenco is.
Okay, starting Benny, guitarist, and he's been forever a guitarist, a flamenco. It's a lifelong dedication. He's played for most of the companies, I think, in Cape Town. Myra, I came to Cape Town 3 years ago. Myra was the first person to join the professional company. I'd moved over from Gauteng, where I was based for maybe 20 years or something. And I decided Cape Town offered more in terms of art, people being passionate about what they do. Deirdre came from the La Rosa company. She started already doing flamenco at school, and then she was in a trainee program, and then she joined us last year. Okay, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So that's it. That's what you get. Now, here's what you got. I hope what you got. I won't fill in for you. Is, of course, a feeling, an emotion. I hope at least a number of you sort of were sort of taken away by that. Right. That's, of course, not what you saw. What you saw was a lot of movement and him playing guitar, etc. That's, of course, not what at the end of the day you get. And that's not what you're going to pay for. If you would go to a performance of them, which is a product or a service, what they offer is nothing more than that. They give performances, and actually they want to give you a great evening. They want to make you feel good. They want to inspire you. I'll later on ask what they really want, since I now fill it in for you. So I'll get back to you later on. But that's what you got. Now, how do you get to this? Right? That's what I want to discuss with you in the hour and a half that we have from here, is how do you get to such a performance? There are very many steps in there. And we'll walk you through those, theoretically, and then I'll ask them to perform step by step. Right? So as to illustrate that you see, hear, and feel what happens there. Okay? That's the purpose of this. I stop there. We try to get a holistic concept. This is clearly a holistic concept. There are loads of things behind here. There's a world of history behind that, right? Which goes back hundreds and hundreds of years, which comes out of the south of Spain, where historically it was a very, very poor region. Actually, it was a very empty region. And I don't know which king of Spain decided to attract the Flemish and the Germans. I hate to say that's where flamenco comes from. I'm actually the only flamenco in this room, since I'm the only Flemish in this room. But the name literally comes from flamencos and alemanes. That's how they say it in Spanish. To bring them down in that area to sort of populate and economically develop the area. Went completely wrong, and eventually a number of gypsies moved in that area, and that is where most of flamenco music is still sort of affiliated with, right? It is that flamenco culture is very much related to the gypsy culture. And you see a lot of flamenco culture there where groups of gypsies settled down, like the south of France, of course, obviously the south of Spain. That is where historically, so you can find flamenco in different places, but very often, if there is any sizable group of people, it will be around sort of a gypsy community, right? Now, it was cheap music. Now, that guitar is not a cheap one, but where flamenco guitar started is actually cheap guitars, since people were extremely poor. And it started, of course, with rhythm. Normally, you have a singer. It's very difficult to find singers here, and you like it or you dislike it. You have to sort of learn to like flamenco singing. So I didn't insist for having that. But this is something which is straightforward to everybody, right? That's the whole culture. Now, you might not have known that. That is behind all this. And, of course, that's not what you buy if you buy this product. That's good to know. It opens you a wider window. It makes you more sense, right? Now, what are we talking about? We're talking about a holistic concept of whatever. And a holistic concept, I have here on the screen, is a theoretical concept of what holism could be. And it is developed by a guy called Ken Wilber. And Ken Wilber says, if you want to understand anything holistically, and we'll illustrate that with flamenco, with the performance that you've seen, which is a holistic performance, we're going to break it down in pieces and reconstruct it holistically. Basically, that's what we're going to do, right? Now, go back to the concept. And I'll give a very simple example. Imagine, so what Ken Wilber says is you have to understand anything on two dichotomies between individual and collective and between internal and external, right? Imagine my stomach hurts. I go to a simple medical doctor. That simple medical doctor over there is going to investigate my stomach as it would be an organ separate from all the rest. It's going to find something. It's going to give me drugs, take them. Pain goes away. Pain comes back since the cause was elsewhere. A more advanced medical doctor, call it an integrative medical doctor, is going to look there in this quadrant, still investigating your stomach, but no longer as a separate organ, but as part of your whole body, paying attention to blood, kidneys, blood pressure, whatever, whatever. Yes, still it is your stomach, but it's going to be considered in a more holistic, technically holistic structure, which is your body, right? However, there's a whole internal side there. And the internal collective side, which is what we call the we site is where we talk about the values. There are cultures that make sick and there are cultures that make happy. The Indian culture for ages didn't know heart attacks. I called up recently, but for a while. Why? Since they have different stress levels, different food, different values, different whatever. There are companies that make sick and there are companies that make healthy. There are companies that unfortunately have suicides. When we were still living in France, France Telecom had 6 suicides in a year. Renault, for those of you driving a Renault, had 6 suicides a year. Now, guys, that's an alarm bell, right? That is something you just for the story, you won't believe that. When they appointed the new CEO at France Telecom, you know what the new strategy of France Telecom became? I should have kicked him out immediately. Growth without suicides. This is not a joke. That was the new strategy. No, serious. Now, that means that you're reasonably sick as an organization. We'll talk further about that, and that's particularly what Erna is going to deal with later this afternoon and tomorrow, but that is sort of what we're talking about. And then last but not least, again, in the individual sphere, in still interior, is emotions. Le malade imaginaire of Molière. If you say 20 times a day, I'm sick, I'm sick, I'm sick, and you do that 20 days, I guarantee you, you'll be sick. If you don't believe me, just try it, right? So, if you want to understand my stomach disease, Ken Wilber says, you'll have to pay attention to those 4 quadrants, right? Those 4 quadrants in the right mix are going to give you a holistic experience. What you got in this performance is nothing less than a holistic experience. If I would now go to all of you and say, what did you see, what did you hear, what did you, you might pick bits and pieces out of that. I imagine you've seen, if you want to try afterwards, just to do that for 5 seconds, what they do with their feet, you have to try and do that. It looks fantastically simple, but I can warn you, it takes you ages to get there. Now, that is not what it is. It is the story of this morning. If you don't master the musical instrument, you certainly can't play. So they all master their musical instrument. I mean, in their case, it's their body. In Benny's case, it's the guitar, right? But they master that. But that's not all. You hear that. Of course you hear that. That's what you really hear. But that's not what you catch. That's, if I would not draw your attention to that, you might not be able to tell me. If I would ask you what he did on his guitar, I'm absolutely sure that you have no clue and you have no idea. You're not able to tell me, is it? Which is fine. But he did. And he did very precisely. And if he wouldn't have done very precisely, it wouldn't have been brought together in a holistic experience that you have felt, right? Now, this is sort of what we try to work around in a company. And if you translate this in a company, and you take the customer view, you are the customer of them. They offer a service. You can even call it a product if you want to. Doesn't matter. They offer you something. So what do you see? You see the product. The product is what you have seen happening, okay? But that is, of course, not what, if you go home tonight and they say, hey, what was this course about? I'm sure you talk about this and not about the rest, I know. But if you even talk about this, then you're not going to describe how well she danced or how, that's not, But it is down there, the product. If you buy a Ferrari, you buy a Ferrari, which is an iron box, right? And it's steel and whatever. But that's, of course, not what you buy. What you buy is the use of something. It is them, and of course, I asked a different product than the product that you got, right? Since my purpose, the use of the product they do for my purpose is different than your use, right? You sort of enjoy this performance. I use it to make my point. So I buy another product from them. So actually, what you buy is not the product. What you buy is the use of the product in a context. If I take my example, the use is very clear. I want you to feel, not to understand, but to feel what excellence is. That's the purpose. That's why I buy this service. Okay? But what really has a value for me is what is the added value for me. The added value for me is that I cannot give you this experience if I wouldn't have them here. I could show you a DVD, I could have you hear some music, I can explain it, but of course it gets nowhere close to having them here and you experiencing the energy, right? You understand what I refer to, the energy that they create, right? But at the end of the day, what I really pay money for is an emotional value. It's a satisfaction. It makes me feel good. I have some sentiment with that since I've lived there, which is yet another dimension. One of the reasons I bought this product is, of course, that I have a faraway affiliation with that. Otherwise, I might possibly have moved to a jazz band, you see? Huh? So all those kinds, that's what, so this touches me specifically since I've been there. I've been around. I even try to still be around on and off, but it doesn't really work out, right? But at the end of the day, you pay since it gives you satisfaction. Agree? So you buy, I've explained this with my own case, you buy a Ferrari, right? In order to use it in a specific context. If you live in the desert, you don't buy a Ferrari since it's too low, so you can't use it. You can only use a Ferrari if you live in Cape Town. That's why you see so many of them, right? But actually, the real value it gives to you is transportation. You're able to move around so that everybody sees you and fast enough. But what you really pay for is the emotion of having a Ferrari. That are the easy brands, the Ferraris, the Harley Davidsons, the whatever. That are the easy brands, since they have easily that emotion. Flamenco, in a way, it's the same. It's an easy brand since you like it or you dislike it. If you dislike it, that's fine. You make a mistake, but that's fine. Right? But it's also relative, it's outstanding. It is something special. It is something that has a very, very strong signature. So in a way, which is another reason that I like to try Flamenco to make this point, since it's very clear. If after this session you walk out, we could say you like it, you don't like it. I'm sure that nobody is halfway in between, other than if they want to be polite to me. Yeah? But other than that, nobody will be halfway in between. Right? Now, that is sort of the concept. If you want to drive that as an organization, that is not what you're going to do. We get to that in a minute. But I first want to illustrate that using the gang. Okay? So, what I'm going to ask, step by step, actually, is sort of go through those four balls. So, and I've asked them to just dance a few minutes, starting with the right upper ball in flamenco, you correct me if I'm wrong, has to do with technique. Technique of the guitar, technique of the dance, technique of the song if we would have it. Actually, you play music technically correct, right? That's where it starts. That is, at the end of the day, physically what happens here in front of you. It is a few people that technically correctly dance and play the guitar. Now, typically in flamenco, I would like to call that it's around the rhythm. You've heard it's a very rhythmic thing. It's behavioral. You see things happening. Right. Now, what I want to ask you is that each of you, just very briefly, perfectly show your technique. Right? So you're not going to dance or whatever, but you show off. Right? That's what I ask you to do. Just to sort of show how technical your dance could be, how technical your guitar can be. Good? Thank you. remarkable thing is that she can't stand that she only dances, so she starts playing with it. That's flamenco. No, that's flamenco. You sort of automatically hit it, right? By the way, if you really want to see gorgeous flamenco, you see, no, it's true. You see some of the most gorgeous flamencos where you are admitted into the family and they play for themselves. You might not have seen that. They don't play for you. They play for themselves, right? And that's what it is. And of course, that is where you get to, well, I'll say what I'd call it later, but that's where you really get to the sentiment of flamenco. Flamenco takes place in the families, right? Sort of a being together, joining together into a big party. And everybody, in a way, can jump in. Eh? That is the nice thing. Huh? So that's how it happened. Good. That is what you've seen down there, or up there. Now, what I'm going to ask them to do in a minute is now all perform together. So there are five parts, if you want, or five instruments, if you want to, in flamenco, as you've seen. And you have the cajon, which is the box, a rhythm box. Then you have the palmas, and if you ever want to try that, I mean, that's an exercise in itself. Then you have the dance, then you have the guitar, and then you have the singer, right? And I think that is sort of what the whole gang is together. Now, very often, if you live in the south of Spain and you go to a performance, people that are lived, born, and raised in flamenco are going to the act as palmas. Just as what you saw there, they get nervous that they're not part of the toy. So when you have a performance, all the people that know how to do that, and it is more difficult than you think, will join in. Very remarkable thing. And that's how you sort of create the value added of that performance. Now, what really happened in front of you technically is that you have a dialogue between, in this case, I said there, between the singer and the guitar, but in this case, between the dancer and the guitar. It's not that they don't rehearse, but there is not a set of rules. They don't agree particularly what is now going to happen. What is happening is sort of a continuous request and answer between the two. And that is where the first level of difficulty hits in, is that you have to be awake and that you have to be aware. And that if she suddenly moves on, then if he isn't awake, then you have a huge cacophony, as they say in French, then you have a huge disharmony. It is the concept of co-creation. Now, there are different rhythms in flamenco. The one where then this is, for me, strongest is bulerias, but that's my idea, where you sort of have a very often sort of an emergence of actions up to very, very, very high speed with the same precision. It's highly impressive, right, to see that. Now, so what I ask you to do, I mean, I ask you to perform for a few minutes in a minute, is to really try and catch. You've heard them one by one. And of course, let's agree on that, it's useless. Eh? I mean, it's nice, it's impressive, but that has nothing to do with flamenco. In the bringing it together, in the harmony, as we call it there, right, in the socialization of what's happening there, and in all bringing it together, you start to create something which has a very remarkable, different from all the rest, sound. Keep an eye on the fact that what you hear is a holistic performance, okay? Beginning, eh? how the palmas and the guitar sort of start to be encouraged. The fact that I sometimes shout to each other has a very particular meaning. It's sort of encouraging each other, right? And that's a way of the dialogue, right? So you sort of encourage the other. Eh? And she shouted there, "Venga, come on, girl." That's what it is, isn't it? Or you say, "Come on, let's show them what you can." Eh? And that's that dialogue that is going on. That's the social dimension. And that sort of becomes the outside part of your product. Now that is still not what you're buying, okay? Now if you continue, then of course there is a whole culture behind this, and there is a whole history behind it that I sort of summarized in 1 minute. There is a spirituality behind it. There is a way of living behind it. If you ever live in the south of Spain, you live flamenco. It is not something that you do there. If you are an outsider like me, you go there and you start following courses and you'll never get there. And those that are born there, they all get it and they do nothing, right? It is really, it's a culture. And that was one of the striking things why I got intrigued by it, since it is one of the forms of music that are really cultural emanations. There's a whole history behind that. There's a whole economy behind that. There's a whole whatever behind that. Now, that is sort of what you see. Now, the thing works or doesn't work. When they arrive, I'm sure you didn't arrive there, and the reason you didn't arrive there is since I asked you to concentrate on what they were doing, which prevented you from enjoying it, right? Of course, I asked you to do that, so it's logic. What I'm now going to ask you is a different story. Now I want to try and build, and that's in your hands if it works, a dialogue between them and you. Since that's what you want. Hey, you want to be part of that. You don't want to sit there and look through the desk. Now you watch a TV screen. Okay? That is not life. What's the difference between a TV screen and life? In life, you're part of it. And the more you can become part of that, the more you're going to enjoy that, the more it's going to add value to you. So that is a dialogue between music and the aficionado. That's a nice word to say, the guy who really likes flamenco, right? It's an aficionado. It's not correct, but that's sort of, say the public. Right? Between the musicians or the music or the dance or the whatever and the public, right? And that is where you create values. So I'm going to ask them again to play. And I'm going to ask you, if you go home tonight, most of you have never seen flamenco, that's good. And they ask you, what is this flamenco all about? What are you going to say? See? What is it, what it brought to you? What did you learn? What does it bring up? Is it history? Is it spirituality? Is it poetry of life? Is it, what is it? If it's nothing, you don't have to answer in the image, right? But I'm going to ask a few of you to come up with what does it mean to you? But not that much in theory, but you sitting there, seeing what they do, what value does it bring to you? Okay, and very simple, what are you going to say outside? Somebody asks you tonight, what was this about, you know? That's what I ask you to do, right? Okay? Thank you. up to you. What are you going to tell tonight?
Storytelling.
Harmony? Storytelling?
Playfulness.
Yeah.
Playfulness. Mm. Right?
Teamwork.
Teamwork, absolutely.
Precision.
Mm. Decisions, yeah.
Endurance.
Sorry?
Endurance.
Yes, endurance. You're going to do more. So it's not yet finished. Yes. Very nice. I mean, I think this is all what you can see in there. Right? And that, of course, is what sort of motivates you as an audience. That is what you catch as an audience. And despite of their technicality, if they wouldn't have their technicality, you wouldn't catch it. But you don't catch their technicality. You catch the things of all what you. Now, the last step in that cycle is, of course, and we sort of touched on it, it's the emotional side. What does it do to you? So when I asked them again to play a little piece, then I want you to concentrate on what does it do to you? Does it make you happy, energetic, maybe you become an alcoholic? What does it do with you? Where and how does it touch you? Since that's where you're going to buy your Ferrari, but at the end of the day, it touches you to sit in that Ferrari, right? So I want to use this as an example. Now, the nice thing is that, of course, that refers to the whole idea of the mystery. And in Flamenco, it is related to the AW. All those songs that they start singing, which you fortunately don't understand, is all about misery and death. Other than that, it's like the opera. So everybody dies at the end of an opera. It's not like what happened in Flamenco. But that plays a very important role. You know, not completely unlike the black tradition in this country. I mean, it's a tradition of people that were economically minor in the society. They were miners, very often, literally. One of the types of song is called mineras, so a song that is made by the miners in the mining area, if I'm right, east, I think, of Spain. Right? So that is what gave them joy, not unlike the singing in the black communities in South Africa. There are some parallels to be drawn. But the nice thing is, it's so fantastic word. It's called duende. Duende is a Spanish word. There's, how do you call them? There's flying things. How do you call them in English? In the fairy tales.
Spirits.
Sorry?
Fairies.
Fairies. Yes. That's it. So that's what it is. Now, flamenco is a real success. And I'm not fair to them, since it's difficult to set that down in 5 to 10 minutes. If you really get a flamenco performance of an hour, whatever, a real performance, it does or does not happen that you get that feeling which is called within the circles duende, which is an undescribable emotional being touched. Right? It is sort of, you occasionally get it, you don't always get it. I think you don't get in the majority of the performances. God knows I've seen performances of flamenco in my life, so you certainly don't get it with all of them. I wouldn't even say you get it in the majority of them, but it is so profound, since it really touches you deep in there. You know it when you get it. You can't describe it. So I can't promise you get it. It does take some time to build that up. But that is very peculiar. Now, what I want you to do is to sort of, I would almost say, concentrate less, enjoy more, and distract a little bit from what you see and the things, and sort of just enjoy the moment, right? And afterwards, I'll ask you, what does it do to you? And what is the emotion that it calls up? So after all the nice things you said of the value it brings to you this evening, if somebody says you, what does it do to you? I want to have that word, right? So do concentrate on that. If I can ask you to play another small piece, I have it almost done. Thank you. What emotion did it call for you?
Probably a sense of anticipation, because any minute they're going to go wild.
Okay. Good enough.
It sure trumps business.
Took me to Portugal and the south of Spain.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Defiance.
Party, fiesta. Things get up and dance.
Right? Party time?
Captivating. Energy. For me, it's just pure energy.
Yes, absolutely.
Intrigue.
Adds that sort of mystery, yeah? That mystical behind it.
No, real sense of sadness. Mm.
Sorry, it is?
A real sense of sadness.
Yes.
Yes, very often, as I say, they all die in the flamenco song, so it's definitely in there.
A relentless engagement with life.
Yes. Yeah, it's a very deep, profound, questioning relation to life. As I said, it often questions the whole issue of death and the other world, the spiritual dimension of new belonging elsewhere, etc. You really catch that out of the music, I absolutely agree with you. Any else?
Yeah, I found it very private. They were dancing together. There was an occasional link with us, but there was strong communication between them.
Yeah.
It was for them, it wasn't for us.
Yeah, well, a good flamenco performance starts with them but ends with you. That's why it takes some time. But you're absolutely right. As I said in the beginning, they sort of play amongst each other. And if they play longer, but you have to be willing and able to engage with them. You see, that's where the dialogue comes in between them and you, right? And where you really get that famous duende at all, it is where the audience can engage with the troupe, right? And that doesn't always work for many good and bad reasons. Eh? I mean, technical reasons, for reasons that people are not relaxed, for reasons that people don't have the mindset in order. We'll talk about mindset and values and emotions with them in a minute. But of course, as much as they have a certain value set and mindset, the dialogue will only come if you sort of are able to touch each other in that. Which is, by the way, true with any music. Yeah, if you sit in a symphony orchestra, it's exactly the same. Okay? But yeah, you know, that observation is right.
I must say, though, there was a time where I was observing him playing the guitar and watch whoever's dancing their feet. So that the music is in sync with what they're doing, and it's almost like anticipation of what they're going to do.
Yeah.
And when she was playing the thing, it also is an anticipation of what's going to happen. So I think that interaction for me between them is also quite interesting. It's quite almost.
Yeah, absolutely, and it's high intensity.
Yeah.
Right? It is the networks I was talking about. They indeed anticipate. I now talk for you. But you sort of, they know each other. But even if they wouldn't know, they try to anticipate in what is going to happen. And that is what brings a lot of the energy in that music. You know, it is that sort of where the energy comes from. This is a high energy sport. If you really watch, no, I mean seriously, this is a high energy physical sport. So of course you don't get the energy there and the energy doesn't start there. And you're not by sitting there that you're going to get the energy over to you. That's absolutely true. Okay? Now that is what you are going to pay for. Okay? That is ultimately where you say, okay, this has touched me. This gives me a I feel good or whatever feeling. I mean, this is some. That is where you're going to pay your money for. It's not for the car. It's not for the transport it gives you. It is for that emotional feeling, right or wrong, that you get. Now, if you want to create this, which I guess is what I would like to call an excellent performance, you drive that not from the product, okay? What we often do in companies is we think, well, if we improve the product and we have the best product and we have whatever, then it's fine. And then the fools just have to understand it and buy it. Right? That is sort of the reasoning that we often have. You don't drive an excellent company from that perspective. You drive an excellent company from the values. And that is what you see happening down here. So what I'd like just to ask anybody of you who would like to answer is, what are your values in doing that? Why do you do this? Why are you in this business? And why is this your product? and not selling Ferraris as another product. What is it? And don't yet move to the emotions, since I'll ask you in a minute the same question about what is your emotion that drives it, but really, why do you do it? Is it culture? Is it whatever? Whoever wants to say something.
I do it because of the passion for it, the love for it, and the intensity of it, the excitement, and also the depths and the profoundness and the mystery of it. And also, it makes me very happy.
That's quite challenging.
That's an emotion.
Yeah, we're very much emotion-driven, unfortunately. It is an emotional thing for us, over and above everything, because from logic, then we have to start looking at our technicality.
Yeah.
But what drives us is the emotion, and it's what makes us go back every day and drain ourselves and retire or whatever. But that is really the passion for it, the music, the unity we feel as a group, not only on a dance level, every day to day, how we relate to each other. We just have such an understanding of where every person is, and we respect that. It's an amazing experience outside of the studio as well as on stage.
It challenges you mentally,
physically,
emotionally, in every aspect of the world. You're going to be challenged on a daily basis. You can be the pro dancer, you can be a beginner.
Yeah.
You're always going to be learning. You're always going to be seeking that knowledge. And you're always actually, you're taught to work together. You're actually bound by the rhythm, by teamwork. Everything gets done together.
Yeah, like the Ferrari would be boring.
Yeah.
Because it's a machine, and what can the machine do? We can shape our Ferrari every day.
Yeah.
You know?
I didn't see you selling Ferraris.
And it's not easy to drive a Ferrari properly.
Yeah.
This Ferrari.
So I love driving this Ferrari.
Yeah, it's another one.
It's very deep when you start speaking about it, but it lies very, very deep. And I feel like whenever I go there, I don't know what I'm going to do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a mystery.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what
mm-hmm.
brings me back every time.
The experience, yeah.
One more thing, the creativity.
Yeah.
In fact, what we've rehearsed, I don't see any of that really. Everybody just ends up doing their own thing. So it always changes. So you never know what to expect, but it's got to remain in sync, and it's got to make sense. And when it works, then it's the best thing that's ever happened.
This, I think, specifically what you said, is sort of the value. Eh? Well, like, they like this, and they don't want to sell Ferraris. I mean, they want to create a Ferrari every day. This is where the values hit in. You sort of hinted to that, and so did you. What drives them is an emotion. Yeah, as you say, I don't know, it comes from deep down. That's the emotion. Although I would insist a little bit, you probably would find some words to express that. You said it very nicely. It is the emotion that drives you, right? Now, that is true for everybody, for every business you run, right? And I go back to that. First of all, what do you add? What is it that sort of you feel you have to bring to the world that the world doesn't have yet, right? And you caught some of that down there. But you can only do that via personal engagement, right? Since you're emotionally, you want that to be done at the end of the day for yourself, right? For your own joy, for your own life, right? That emotional drive is, of course, the second step. Right? I take the same balls that we went differently, but we got through the same steps. Then, and only then, you will get to the behavior, as you nicely said, that motivates you to train, which you have to if you want to become anywhere close to good in this. And by the way, if you want to become anywhere close to good in anything, hey, this is of course genuinely true for whatever. This is true in what you try to do. If you really want to build an excellent company, you do not build it up there. Yes, you need to have the technique, but you build it there in the values, and you build it by you living those values emotionally, which will allow you then to motivate you to do the stuff you have to do day after day, and to sort of, You know, enjoy what you do. Eh? What you said, you rehearse for nothing, so somebody goes off and plays whatever. Now that is part of the value of the thing, as you described it before. You can only do that. You can only follow each other since you share those values. This is part of the game. Eh? I think for all of you, this is part of the game. It's that interaction, that networking, that co-creating all the time. So when you're up there and performing, since I recall, that's what we saw. Right? What we saw is what happened there in the upper right corner. That's what you have seen visually. That only gets created since they share that concept of co-creation, and they share that emotionally driven. And that allows them to organize even unorganized. This is a fantastic example of self-organization. Right? I said you this morning. This, together with Charles and some other things, but this is one of, for me, the most simple and clear expressions of self-organization. I've been around many of those things, and I always hear the same. They all rehearse, and it never works out the way they rehearse. So it's not him, it's not them, it just happens like that. And it's the nature of the product, right? Now, that is, of course, typically the nature of this product. This is equally the nature of any product, right? And then, at the end of the day, with the correct values, with the correct emotions, having the right technique, you're able to sort of build the performance they built and bring that to the audience, right? Since that is what you like to do. Okay. Now, at the end of the day, if you really would like this to be a lasting product, they will have to make sure that you, audience, are satisfied. Okay? Since otherwise you walk out and you become the best negative publicity for what they do. Say this was useless, we didn't like it, etc. So if you really want now to make sure that you're going to last as an excellent company, you'll have to do two more steps. The one is go back and make sure, which I won't be able to do, but make sure that you really liked it, right? And if you want to be sure that you get repeat business, and you really run your business without any effort, you'll have to make sure that you are that the client is emotionally linked to what they do. In which case, you're going to ask her to be on the mailing list of their performances, and you're going to go to all their performances. Then you have a repeat client. Right? That's what it is. Right? I mean, you can't have a repeat client with Ferraris. Well, you can, but it's sort of the basic example. Here you have typically repeat clients. And people that really like it, they are going to, well, not possibly go every time, but they're going to go.
We do a show, and then 3 weeks later, we're going to repeat the show elsewhere. And people rebook, and it's like, you guys know, we're repeating the show. And it's like, no, we want to come. Because every time it's slightly different. It's got another energy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's in action. It's what we discussed this morning. What you've seen is in action, not action. If I would play, which I'm not going to do, of course, if I would play, I would act, I would not enact. And of course, that is where it goes wrong. If you don't have that emotion up there, then it is not going to work. Right? That is what drives. Many of us don't have that emotion. And we run the business non-enactive, which means that every second day, it roughly sounds the same. Now, then you don't come back. If you really enact your play the way they do, then indeed every evening, though they try to do the same anyway, it doesn't work out. But though they try to do the same, still it is different since you enact it differently. Okay? Now before I'm going to ask them to do a nice roundup show for you, I would like to summarize what we said for companies. So I've used Flamenco as a metaphor, clearly. And as a difficult product. Right? Flamenco, in our way of thinking, is not an easy problem, right? So I've used that in order to showcase you that every product can be analyzed the way we try to do that. And every product follows, or every company follows, the same logic. Value, to personal mastery of those values, to organization, to the social dimension, the relevance dimension, making sure that your client likes what you do, and eventually trying to build what I like to call customer intimacy. That's how you call it. So back to a company now, you run your company from values. And we'll get back to that afterwards. Contribution, purpose, meaning, belonging, making a positive change. Right? They've given a number of those reasons in what they said when I asked them why they did it for. Then it's about personal mastery. It's about taking accountability and responsibility for what they do, really enacting their way of living, right? It's about awareness. God knows they have to be aware. They have to follow each other, and they create that awareness every second again. It's about respect for each other. Yeah? It's about how to sort of be a leader while being a follower, and being a follower while being a leader. You know, that kind of thing. If you don't respect each other, you don't get to this performance. Okay? If somebody really thinks that he or she is the best and all the others are useless, then you're not going to fly far. You have that mentality a little bit in business. No, but it's true. And it's essentially, it's based on respect. Then and only then, you're going to organize yourself in such a way as to be continuously on the business model innovation side. And what Tanya says is that every performance, in a way, is an innovation of the previous one. Each time you sort of do something different, since you feel it goes better, it sounds better, it works better. So it's a continuous cycle in the process side of business model innovation. You have to get it right. If they technically can't perform, they're unable to do this, right? But that sort of is a minimum condition. If you don't have it, you don't play. Right? You're not in the ball game. But even if you have technically all the skills, still, you might not be in the ball game. Right? And then the ball game of offering and reoffering is each time over and again innovate what you're doing. And eventually you're going to get to that idea of living in society, having relevance, living in complexity, living in diversity. Right? They're all different. They're all, if I just take the dancers for a minute, they're all three absolutely different. Right? So that diversity you can use or you can deny. If you use it, you perform something. If you deny it, you get into war. That's what it is. You have to do it like that. You have to do it like that. It doesn't work. It really doesn't work, right? So, in the summary, so if you really want an excellent company, start from values, go to personal mastery, then you start organizing with the purpose to realize your values. That is what I do. And then you become a relevant company that afterwards verifies whether they get customer satisfaction, and eventually whether they can create customer intimacy. So you drive from what I call this morning the consciousness of the organization. The driver of any sustainably excellent company is the consciousness. What drives your company? What do you share? What is your vision? What is it that you really would like the world to know you for? That is what sort of drives you. Then it's the personal mastery of those values. How do I live that? Right? How is it part of my entire being? How is it part of my getting up in the morning and motivate myself to do what I have to do in order to live that consciousness? Then and only then, you are going to business model innovate, you're going to create and recreate and enact and all the time move on, right? And eventually you will perform a relevant performance, you will deliver a relevant product, in order to make sure that you have delivered the correct service quality. Since that is what, at the end of the day, the client buys. You drive from values over personal mastery. You produce and hopefully you deliver a relevant service. But the client still isn't interested in your values. The client is interested in the emotions that he or she gets from buying your stuff. That is what the client is interested in. The client hits in there. The client hits in by seeing the performance. That is where you hit in. You don't hit in their motivation and in their emotions. You don't. I asked them and therefore they shared that with you, but normally you wouldn't know. Right? That is not what you hear or see if you go to a performance. You hit in at the upper right side. That's where you see. And then eventually you hope, they hope, you hope, that it gets you an emotional touch. Right? And then last but not least, you make sure that the client has an emotional link with your company, an emotional link with the company, that they enjoy being here. And that enjoyment creates kind of a family. That's the Harley Davidson owners group, right? I mean, if you have a Harley, then you're sort of a mandatory member of that group. Now that is sort of the intimacy that you would like to create. If you sort of have that gang of people that run around your company, so to say, then you know that while you're doing the right things, but it even gives you your survival. And it brings you enough business so that you can live from that. Now, just to wrap it up, I would like to ask you to give us a last little performance, if you're willing to do so, just to enjoy it. No further questions to you, no further questions to you, just for the fun.
Thank you. Thank you.